آمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وكفى، وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. All praises due to Allah alone. We praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one. And whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the greatest peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear beloved brothers and sisters, allow me to begin by making this dua. Oh Allah, make it easy for all of us to meet in Mecca, in Medina, and on Arafah this year. Enable us to perform Hajj together and make it the best Hajj ever. And accept every effort of us. Allahumma ameen. What we need right now, all of us, is just to make lots of dua. Because as Abu Amina, Brother Ahmad Atif, just introduced, there are a lot of challenges. But we're pretty certain that the Almighty Allah will make it very easy. I'd like to confirm that you can hear me clearly and the sound is okay. You can simply type number one if the sound is okay. Just type number one. You don't have to worry about writing anything. No? Okay. Okay. If the vast majority have the sound okay at the end, then those who are having number two, they need to check their system. Basically, Brother Tariq. May Allah make it easy for all of us. Brothers and sisters, today actually, we started the first day of the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, the three consecutive sacred months. As you know that the Almighty Allah stated in Surah At-Tawbah, إِنَّ عِدَّةَ الشُّهُورِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ 12 شَهْرًا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Since Allah, the Almighty, has created the heavens and the earth, the number of months are 12. Four out of them are sacred. Dhul-Qa'dah, which just began today, Dhul-Hijjah, and Muharram, these are three consecutive months. And then Rajab by itself. Before we delve into the topic of the virtues of the first 10 days of the month of Dhul-Hijjah, which will begin in 1 month from now, inshallah, I'd like to bring to your attention that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said in the sound hadith, أعمار أمتي بين الستين والسبعين وأقلهم من يجوز ذلك. The average lifespan of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is 60, 70. Few of them will make it to 80, then obviously fewer to 90 or to 100. So basically, the lifespan nowadays is pretty short compared to in the past where people used to live hundreds of years. And when the lifespan is short, that means we do not have that much time to show gratitude to the Almighty Allah, thank Him enough, do enough worship in order to be eligible for salvation or enter paradise and be saved. That's why the Almighty Allah is the most gracious, the most generous, the most merciful, have blessed us with the following gift. إِنَّ لِلَّهِ فِي أَيَّامِ دَهْرِهِ نَفَحَاتٍ. Because our lifespan is very short, and as you know that our deeds will not be recorded against us until we reach the age of puberty. So average 15 years, if we take the average lifespan 60, so 15 out of the 60, no accountability. 45 years left, 20 years out of them sleeping. Don't you sleep 8 hours a day? Yeah, average people do sleep 8 hours a day. So how much time left? 20, 25 years between eating, drinking, working, earning, studying, and then worship. So really the time that we have to prove to the Almighty Allah that we love Him and we are willing to fulfill every command of His and to pass the test that which He created us for is very short. But the most generous, the Almighty Allah, have blessed the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with virtues and blessings that He did not grant any nation before us. Take for instance what I mentioned earlier in the hadith, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ فِي أَيَّامِ دَهْرِهِ نَفَحَاتٍ. The Almighty Allah scattered special occasions, special seasons of goodness with extra virtues, where the reward for the simple good deeds will be augmented, not just doubled or tripled, multiplied. It will be beyond imagination, augmented in a way that you cannot imagine it. So for instance, a month ago, we finished Ramadan, mashallah. And we all know that one night in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, Allah the Almighty said it's a blessed night. And this night, its worship is better than the worship that is observed in Al-Fishah, 83 years and a few months, doing nothing but worshiping the Almighty Allah. So if you worship Allah on a single night, which is Laylatul Qadr, that gives you an access to another extra complete lifespan, 83 years plus, doing nothing but worshiping the Almighty Allah, because He's most generous. Then you find the Almighty Allah scatters also throughout the year beautiful seasons, such as the 9th of Muharram, at the 10th of Muharram, and the 9th of Dhul Hijjah. The 10th of Muharram, which is Ashura, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said that fasting on the 10th of Muharram or Ashura expiates the sins of the entire past year. This is an opportunity not to be missed. Since also on the 10th or the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, fasting on the day of Arafah, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, it expiates all the sins of the past year and the sins of the year to come. And there is no other good deed whatsoever that guarantees forgiveness for sins in advance before you do them, other than fasting on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, which is the day of Arafah. And we can go on and on, special occasions, special days. Fasting for the 6 days of Shawwal along with Ramadan is rewarded as if you fasted for the entire year. And if you do this on a regular basis, you will be rewarded on the Day of Judgment as a person who's been fasting on every single day for his or her entire lifetime. That shows for certain that the Almighty Allah is the most generous and the most merciful. And He wants all of us to pass the exam. He wants all of us to be eligible, not just to enter paradise, but to be in Al-Firdaus Al-A'la. You know that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, whenever you ask Allah for heaven, don't settle for anything. Don't say it is enough just to enter Jannah. No. Nahi. Rather, you should aim high. You should say, Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-firdaus al-a'la min al-jannah. That is the topmost part of Jannah. This is the top floor in heaven. Right on top of it is the throne of the Almighty Allah. This is where Prophet Muhammad and all the prophets and the companions and the martyrs will be there. So when you ask, aim high. Ask Allah for al-firdaus al-a'la. Let's say, Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-firdaus al-a'la min al-jannah. It would be best if the brothers and sisters who are asking questions not related to the topic, and they keep us busy, if they can postpone their valuable questions until we finish. It's only 35 minutes or so, but it is very distracting. I would really appreciate that. Unless if it is something related to the topic, then please you can postpone it. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Barakallahu feekum. So now we got the idea why the Almighty Allah, the Most Merciful, distributed and scattered throughout the year the seasons of goodness, nafahat. You know when they say there is 70% discount in maces. And guess what? Today there is even 30% on the remaining 30%. So basically, it's like you're getting the items almost for free, less than 10% of its regular price. Oh, people go there even before the stores open. And some people, like, you know, whenever they release a new version of PlayStation and they say there is only limited edition and a certain number, I see people camping and sleeping in the sleeping bags in front of the stores for days before in order to be the first to get it. The believers are more zealous to achieve success through taking advantage of these virtuous times than anyone who is seeking dunya or any success in the dunya. Because the ultimate success, listen to this ayah. Listen to this beautiful ayah. I believe it is ayah number 185, chapter number 3, Surah Ali Imran. Listen, the Almighty Allah says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. You know what it means? You, me, every living creature will definitely perish, will die. Every soul, everything that had a beginning will definitely have an ending. And then it is only on the day of resurrection we will receive our wages on full. We'll be compensated whether good for good or bad for bad on the day of judgment. And then listen to this. A person who will be moved away from hellfire and makes it safely to heaven is the person who have achieved success. And that is indeed the ultimate success. So the true believers, they search for these virtuous seasons, for the occasions where they can increase the balance of their good deeds. So that on the day of judgment, when Allah the Almighty sets up the scales, the parts which have the good deeds will be very heavy and outweigh the part which have our sins and the bad deeds. For that reason, we're having today's session to remind each other with the importance and the virtues of the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah, which will begin in a month from now, inshallah. As you know that the Almighty Allah started Surah Al-Fajr by swearing, وَالْفَجْرُ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ. Whenever the Almighty Allah swears to anything, it signifies that item or subject or thing which Allah swears to is really precious, not to be missed. So it says, I swear to the first 10 days and nights of the month of Dhul Hijjah. That means this time is very precious, and indeed it is. That's why in Surah Al-Hajj, chapter number 22, and number 28, the Almighty Allah says, وَيَذْكُرُ اسْمَ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ. Those known days not to be missed. The first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah is mentioned also in Surah Al-Hajj in ayah number 28. And accordingly, Allah the Almighty is giving us not a hint, a clear guidance what you should be doing most in those days. The greatest is increase remembering Allah, increase celebrating the praise of Allah. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say with regards to the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah? جابر بن عبد الله, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, narrated that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أفضل أيام الدنيا أيام العشر. The best days in life, in the entire life, the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah. And the greatest good deed and the greatest reward for any good deed a Muslim would do is during the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah. To the extent that he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن أفضل منها في هذه العشر. So he made it crystal clear. There are no other days during which good and righteous deeds will be better than the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah. The reward for them is unlimited. And the same good deeds which we do in any other time, they have a specific reward and it is known. But when you do the same in the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah, don't ask about the reward. It is augmented beyond your imagination. Whether it is fasting, giving in a charity, visiting your relatives, helping the poor, visiting the sick, attending the funeral prayer, praying at night, you name it. And obviously performing Umrah and Hajj. And those 10 days, of course, they have the day of Arafah. And the day of Arafah is considered the greatest day of the year. There is actually a greater day. Most Muslims think the day of Arafah is the greatest, but there is actually a greater day, which is the following day. The Eid day, Yawm al-Nahr, as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, أعظم أيام الله عند الله يوم النحر. And Yawm al-Nahr, the day of the sacrifice or the Eid day, is actually the 10th day of the month of Dhul Hijjah. And the 9th is the day of Arafah. The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, has guided us as what one should be doing best during this time. Let's begin with, if Allah blessed you with the invitation, to visit his house, the invitation to be honored, to be forgiven your sins, and to increase you in wealth and health and accept your dua. Because actually this is how it is. The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, Al-Hajj wal-Umrah, performing Hajj and Umrah, yanfiyan al-faqra wal-zunub. Many people think, oh, Hajj is very costly and Umrah last Ramadan, it costs me a lot. Wallahi, Allah gives you more. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Performing Hajj and Umrah, following up on performing Hajj and Umrah, yani more than once, they do two things. They remove sins and they prevent poverty. وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَهُوَ يُخْلِفُ. Whatever you spend of a thing for Allah's sake, Allah will replace it. Not with the same, or something much better, because you've done this for the sake of Allah. الْعُمْرَةُ إِلَى الْعُمْرَةُ كَفَّارَةُ لِمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. Performing Umrah after another Umrah is an expiation for the sins which were committed in between. وَالْحَجُّ الْمَبْرُورُ لَيْسَ لَهُ جَزَاءٌ إِلَّا الْجَنَّةُ. And mashallah, when you're invited to perform Hajj and you do it properly, then the least reward for such Hajj is to enter Jannah. That is the least reward. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, which is agreed upon its authenticity. Also, fasting. The general hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيهن خير منها في هذه العشر. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke in general. Any good deed, you name it, including fasting. Obviously, other than fasting during Ramadan, because this is obligatory, so it is the best. We're talking about voluntary fasting. Fasting during those days is superior to fasting any other voluntary fasting. Whether fasting on the first day or the second day or the third day or the eighth day, It is recommended among the list of the virtuous deeds. But fasting on the ninth day, which is the day of Arafah, is only prescribed for those who are not performing Hajj. Those who are performing Hajj will be on Arafah. And Allah the Almighty wants them to spare their effort and energy so that they can supplicate. That is the day on which you make dua. All your good du'as will be answered, guaranteed. Those will be in Arafah. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْ يَوْمٍ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ أَنْ يُعْتِقَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ عَبَدًا مِنْ عِبَادِهِ مِنَ النَّارِ مِنْ يَوْمِ عَرْفَةٍ. There is no other day during which Allah releases and pardons people from hellfire more than on the day of Arafah. Everyone who had performed Hajj and happened to be in Arafah and his journey was covered from lawful earning would be forgiven. And by the end of the day at sunset, when Allah will say, go home, مَغْفُورًا لَكُمْ, I have forgiven you all your sins. So those who are watching the pilgrims on television and on the screens and shedding tears, say, I wish I was there. Last year and the year before, when we were not able to perform Hajj, when we were watching the few people of the local ones, the extremely lucky people performing Hajj, who could resist our tears? And then when I got an invitation to go to cover Hajj, but only from the media perspective, and to stay in Aziziyah, and I'm not allowed to perform Hajj, I said, I can't just go all the way to Mecca and not dress up in Ihram and watch the Hujjaj and sit back. No way. I'm not doing this. And we were crying. So I want you to think of all those hundreds of millions of Muslims sitting and watching the Hujjaj, envying them in a good sense. Lucky you guys. And inshallah, this year, hopefully, we pray sincerely. We ask Allah the Almighty to extend in our lives and to grant us health and to make us able to perform Hajjan Mabrura, an accepted Hajj, and to ease every difficulty so that inshallah we can go and perform Hajj this year. What about those who are not as fortunate as you? There, a Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prescribed for them fasting. And he said, fasting on the ninth day, which is the day of Arafah, for those who are not performing Hajj, expiates all the sins of the past year and a year to come. I'd like to bring to your attention, brothers and sisters, every time that the Messenger of Allah speaks about the forgiveness of sins or pardoning collateral sins, he is addressing the minor sins. But the major sins require an independent tawbah. And this is what we should begin the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah with, whether you're performing Hajj or not. Sincere repentance. Allah the Almighty says, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. He's calling upon all the believers to repent and repent frequently in order to achieve success. And in Surah Al-Baqarah, the Almighty Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Allah loves whom? التَّوَّابِينَ. التَّوَّابِينَ is an extensive form from تائبين. يعني they do not only repent once or twice or 10 times or 100 times. No. تَوَّاب, all the time is repenting. تَوَّاب, frequently seeking forgiveness. He loves such person, those who frequently beg Allah for forgiveness. So, whether you remember you've committed a sin or not, repent. But if you know that you are used to commit a major sin, dealing with usury, bribery, theft, not wearing hijab, drinking, watching what Allah has forbidden, you name it, then in order to be forgiven entirely, you need to make an independent tawbah for this particular sin. That applies to Hajj, that applies to Umrah, that applies to fasting during Ramadan, and even Laylatul Qadr. So, in addition to the fasting, al-dhikr, Allah the Almighty loves al-dhikr so much that He said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا وَسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. Oh, you believe, celebrate the praise of Allah much as you can. And glorify His praise in the morning and in the evening and every time, especially during those days. You know what? There is a hadith I want to share with you. Somebody might ask, Sheikh, what is the benefit of performing tawaf? And why do we do sa'i? Actually, why do we throw the stones? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam answered this question. He said, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الطَّوَافُ بِالْبَيْتِ وَالسَّعْيُ بَيْنَ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةِ وَرَمْيُ الْجِمَارِ مِنْ أَجْلِ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. These are all different rites of Hajj and stations. And with each station, there are adhkar to be celebrated, to be recited, to celebrate the praise of the Almighty Allah. So take advantage of this precious time and celebrate the praise of Allah. As you know, from the first day of the month of Dhul Hijjah, it is recommended to make takbir, whether to do like what we do in Eid, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd, or to add Allahu Akbar kabira, walhamdulillahi kathira, wa subhanallahi bukratan wa asila. And you know, the Sahaba were very smart. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with all of them, they used to go out to the marketplace. Abdullah and Abu Huraira have no plan to buy anything, nor to sell. But because it is crowded, so they would raise their voices with the takbirat. And once they start with the takbirat, everyone around them remembers and they start making takbirat. Abdullah Umar Khattab used to make takbir in his house out loud so that everyone around him, or in his tent in Mina, everyone around him will remember and raise his voice with the talbiyah, with the takbir, with the dhikr. It's in Surah Al-Kahf. The Almighty Allah says, المال والبنون زينة الحياة الدنيا. No doubt, children and money are the most beautiful things in this life, right? The beauty of this life. Then he says, والباقيات الصالحات خير عند ربك ثوابا وخير أملا. But al-baqiyat, the remaining, salihat, righteous, the everlasting, the remaining righteous deeds, khayrun inda rabbika thawaban, better before your Lord, irrespective of reward, wa khayrun amala, and better irrespective of hope. What are al-baqiyat salihat? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us what Allah is referring to in al-baqiyat salihat, which are even better than all the wealth of the dunya and all the children, is to keep saying, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-azim. Supplicate as much as you can during those days. And the most comprehensive dua and the greatest supplication ever is what Allah has mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah, I believe in ayah number 201, with regards to how to make dua in Hajj. Now you can make it anytime, whether in the Hijjah, the first 10 days or nights or before or after. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ, which means, our Lord, grant us a goodly reward in this life and a goodly reward in the hereafter, and protect us against the fire of hell. Given in charity, we said it is virtuous anyway, but in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, the reward is a lot greater than given in a charity during any other time. So those who didn't pay their zakat during Ramadan, they can pay it in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And increase as much as you can, because whatever you spend will come back to you, but more and more, 10 times more, as the Almighty Allah promised in the Quran. Feeding those who are in need, upholding the ties of kinship, visiting those who are sick, sponsoring some orphans. Any good deed you meet on the way, you heard about a funeral, do not miss it. Attend it. Anything that you can do in order to capture and gain and take advantage of the virtues of the first 10 days of the month of Dhul-Hijjah, do not miss it whatsoever. That would lead us to the fact that we're talking way in advance about how to make the best use and take advantage of this wonderful opportunity, right? Why? Because as they say, if you fail to plan, then simply you're planning to fail. As Ramadan passed by, many people have taken advantage of every minute. I know some people finished the Quran 5 times. They distributed lots of zakah and sadaqah. And they have witnessed Laylatul Qadr, and they knew which night is it. Because every night they were praying to Hajjud. So they took advantage of the whole month of Ramadan in a row. They didn't select and choose. MashaAllah. There are other people who say, yeah, tomorrow, next week, when I take off, when I take a vacation, I'm planning to do this. And Ramadan is over. And same old, nothing have changed. I'll tell you why. Because they did not plan in advance. So the first 10 days of the month of Dhul-Hijjah are the best time in the entire lifetime. And that's why I have to plan in advance. And those days must be a turning point in my life. Then I have to quit sins. I have to understand that I'm in a sacred time. I have to renew my covenant with the Almighty Allah. I have to uphold the ties of kinship with those whom I know that they have hurt me and they have, you know, did bad things to me. But I'm going to stretch out my hand to them and say, Assalamu alaikum, and uphold the ties of kinship. Why? Because if you want to be forgiven, then you got to be forgiven. If you want to be pardoned, then you got to be pardoning yourself. So by forgiving people, by pardoning people, the Almighty Allah will make you eligible for His pardoning and for His forgiveness. So determination to make the first 10 days of the month of Dhul-Hijjah best of the best, whether you want to finish the entire Quran once or twice, whether you are planning to give so much in a charity. And obviously, it is recommended to fast from the first day to the 9th day of the month of Dhul-Hijjah. The 9th is the day of Arafah if you're not performing Hajj. And fasting on the 10th is haram, because the 10th day of the month of Dhul-Hijjah is the Eid day. Yamul Hajj al-Akbar. And similarly, the following 3 days, Ayyam al-Tashriq, it is not permissible to fast on the 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th. A smart brother or sister would say, Sheikh, I normally fast 13th, 14th, and 15th of every lunar month because this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam recommended. Yes, you're right, smart you, but you just said that on the month of Dhul-Hijjah, fasting on the 13th is haram, correct? So what we're gonna do? Fast 14th, 15th, and 16th, but don't fast on the 13th. Why not? Because it's Eid day. Oh, so Eid al-Adha, 4 days, the first day, then Ayyam al-Tashriq, we don't fast. And Eid al-Fitr, how many days? You can just type the number. How many days? Eid al-Fitr, Bismillah. Is this a silly question? No. I don't mean anything. But I mean to tell you that it's only one day. Sheikh, let people have fun, man. Why do you guys want to confiscate every happiness? Let's have fun, make them 3, make them 6. It's okay. I'm just saying, Rihan, that when I say Eid al-Fitr is one day, That means if you want to begin fasting as early as the second day of Shawwal, like you want to fast the 6 days, Al-Ayyam al-Bayd, it's permissible. Because the second day of Shawwal is not a Eid day. It's only the first day. But in the month of Dhul Hijjah, Eid al-Adha, first day, second day, third, and fourth, that is the 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th. And those are the days during which we make takbirat, specific takbir for Eid, after every prayer until the Asr of the 13th day. That is the fourth day at sunset, khalas. And also we offer the Udhiyah. What is the difference between Udhiyah and Hajj and Fidyah? And I'll tell you quickly. Al-Udhiyah, if you're not performing Hajj, it's an emphatic sunnah. If you have the means, one sheep is sufficient for you and your household. If you want to offer more, a whole cow or camel by yourself, mashallah, may Allah bless you. If you're performing Hajj, the Almighty Allah says in the Quran, فَمَنْ تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ إِلَى الْحَجِّ فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَجِ. الهج is a ransom, or I'm sorry, is a, the sacrifice, which is again one sheep, one ram per each Hajj. For each Hajj. If you're performing Umrah and Hajj at the same time, if you've done any Umrah during the month of Shawwal, then you've done Hajj, Dhul Hijjah, you are required to give a Hajj. Obviously, if you cannot afford, there is another exception. But this is the Hajj. And if you perform a Hajj and you offer the Hajj, then you're not required to offer the Udhiyah. While Al-Fidya, same sheep, but it is slaughtered with a different intention. It is if you have made any violation during Hajj, such as you didn't spend the night in Muzdalifah, you skipped Tawaful Wada', you didn't throw the stones, so you give, you slaughter. You pass the miqat without making the ihram, so you give the fidya. And in the case of the fidya, you're not allowed to taste it. The whole thing will be distributed among the poor people in Mecca. Everyone, if a couple, a husband and wife are going together, and the children, even a child, one sheep per each person. But the udhiyah, one sheep is sufficient for the entire household. And the udhiyah, you eat and you host people and you distribute some. Likewise with the hajj. That's why, mashallah, in Mina, Brother Ahmed Atif and Darul Salam team, when we slaughter, mashallah, a lot of heads for the hajj. On the day, on the Eid day, they bring us a lot of kapsa and meals. We eat from the sacrifice that we have offered. Alhamdulillah wa shukrullah. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you this, to be frank with you. I can continue talking for another 1 hour about the virtues of Dhul Hijjah and what we need to do and what we should be doing and planning and so on. But it's not about much of talking. It's about just simply planning. Like a sniper. Planning to take advantage of this time. Let's plan in advance. Let's plan in advance. And one advice. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Addallu ala al-khayri lahu mislu ajri fa'ili." Yani, if I have shared with you in this talk, in this lecture, and I thank Darul Salam for giving me the opportunity to do so, and then 10 people out of you say, "Oh my God, I didn't know that. Definitely, I'm going to fast. Even in Hajj, I'm going to fast the first all the way to the 8th, but the 9th I cannot fast because I'm in Arafah." So they will be rewarded. And this poor man will receive a similar reward. Why? You initiated that. The reminder. وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Maybe we all know the information, but somebody is refreshing our memories. So the reminder will benefit whom? The believers. May Allah make us among them. You don't know how much I love you all for the sake of Allah. Sheikh, how could you say that and you don't even know who are we and who is who and who is not who? I love you because sparing this time now, and what day is today? That's a working day, isn't it? Yeah? Still Wednesday. Now it is Thursday in Cairo, Egypt. And you spare some time to listen to this and to benefit. And I'm sure you're making plans to practice and to take advantage of the beautiful meritorious and virtuous days, then you guys are good people, mashallah. I trust that you are very righteous people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and your family members, all your loved ones. If any of you is sick or having a sick person in the family, may Allah give you shifa. And may Allah make it quick. A quick, a speedy, and a full recovery. If any of you is going through a financial difficulty, may Allah make it easy for all of us. May Allah ease our way. If any of us is grieved for any reason, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove your grief. And may Allah fill your hearts with peace, with tranquility. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all steadfast on the straight path. إني داع فأمنه. اللهم إنا نحمدك ونستعينك ونستهديك ونستغفرك ونؤمن بك ونتوكل عليك ونصلي ونسلم على خاتم رسلك وأفضل خلقك سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا دقها وجلها. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا. أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر، لا إله إلا أنت. اللهم إنا نسألك باسمك الأعظم الذي إذا سئلت به أجبت وإذا دعيت به أجبت. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم إنا نسألك الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة. اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا واهلك أعداءنا واختم بالباقيات الصالحات أعمالنا. اللهم ردنا إلى دينك ردا جميلا. اللهم هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا واجعلنا من عبيدك السعدة. اللهم يسر لنا الحج هذا العام يا رحمن، واجعله حجا مبرورا وذنبا مغفورا وسعيا مشكورا وتجارة لن تبور. اللهم يسر لنا الحج والعمرة هذا العام وتقبلها منا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اخلف علينا، اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين، وسلام على المرسلين، وصلى الله على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته شيخنا، جزاكم الله خير.
جزاكم الله خير. جزاكم الله خير. ألف عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.